Hello and welcome to Newsclick. As you all know, Indian banking sector at present is going through a crisis due to the mounting NPAs. 2 days ago, government has announced recapitalisation of the public sector banks. So to talk about this issue, today we have here with us Prof. C P Chandrasekhar. Hello sir, welcome to Newsclick.
Nice to be here once again.
Sir, what do you think of the recapitalization that government has announced? There has been a lot of coverage in the newspapers saying that this actually amounts to a bailout of the big capital.
Well, first, what does one say about the recapitalization itself? As many people have already noted, there is obviously a sleight of hand here, because in essence, what you're saying is you're not going to show it in the budget excepting for 18,000 crores, which was in any case something which had been all allotted as part of the budget. You know, there was this earlier an idea that there'd be 20,000 crores or 25,000 crores, and there's about 18,000 crores they now say are going to be come directly from the budget. So you're really saying that the chunk of the recapitalization or bailout or whatever you want to call it essentially consists in the fact that 1,35,000 crores is going to be mobilized by the issue of recapitalization bonds, and another 58,000 crores ostensibly through the sale of public bank equity, which would dilute the government share. Now, as far as the sale of 58,000 crores of public bank equity is concerned, the problem would be that so long as bank books are sort of burdened with these large volumes of non-performing assets, and they begin to tell as these NPAs are actually provided for, they begin to tell on profits in a major way, it will be either near impossible to sell a significant amount of public bank equity, or it would have to be sold at prices, which would actually be prices which would not make sense, would actually be handing over a major public infrastructure in terms of banking infrastructure to private players at a pittance, and therefore would prove extremely controversial. So I think the whole plan really hinges on the ability to use the 1,35,000 crores to be mobilized through the issue of these bonds to actually recapitalize these banks. And once they're recapitalized, obviously then to put a certain amount of equity in the market would not be so difficult, because what you're doing is you're first cleaning the books of the bank, and then you're asking the private sector to come and buy into them. And they obviously would remain significantly profitable assets so long as they run properly. Now, the difficulty, of course, with this 1,35,000 crores is that one is the government obviously doesn't want to show this in the budget. But the fact that the chief economic advisor has already said that, listen, this is going to result in interest payments on the budget of something like 8,000-9,000 crores is clearly an indication that this is something which should sit if accounting is done as per what would be appropriate norms. This should sit in on the budget, and therefore people are not going to be, are not going to buy into the idea that this is not something which would implicitly amount to an outlay of public resources, okay, in the form of future resources, because it amounts to the government issuing these bonds to borrow money for the budget, which is then going to be used to recapitalize the banks. Now, assume that the government actually doesn't put this on its books, as it claims it's not going to. That doesn't mean that people are not going to say that there is some problem with this. This is essentially a kind of an attempt to bail out the banks, or to sort of, improve the book position of the banks and write off their non-performing assets by essentially putting a burden on the budget, which is not being shown. But it would be, because very clearly, where is the interest payment going to come from, which essentially means that at some point of time, the capital will also have to be paid out by the government. Now, okay, that is as far as the first part of it is concerned. How are you going to mobilize the money? Or what exactly are these bonds, and how are they independent of the budget? The second part is, who's going to buy these bonds? And the expectation is that the very banks which actually are going to be recapitalized are going to buy into these bonds. Okay, so the idea is that the banks would now, instead of lending money, which they don't want to lend because of the already large amounts of non-performing assets, would use their deposit basis, their deposit resources, to invest in government bonds. This money would then be used to recapitalize the public banking system. You're in essence saying that what you're going to do is you're going to tell banks to actually invest in government securities and use the money from that to give it back to the banks, which also is a strange sleight of hand. So altogether, this is going to be something which is quite controversial, because as far as the real part of it is concerned, which is the 1,35,000 crores, it really is something in which the accounting is going to be a fraudulent accounting process. Now, as far as the other part of your question, very briefly, which is that that this bailout is really a bailout of big business. That would be true, because implicitly, the moment you say that I'm going to actually go and put money, recapitalize these banks, you're saying that you do not expect the technical write-off in terms of the technical write-off of NPAs, which you have to, you're forced to do because of the RBI guidelines, is not going to convert itself into a process in which there's going to be a significant amount of recovery. That is, you can actually say that I'm going to have a complete write-off, I'm not going to get back this money. You can have some kind of a compromise where you say that, let's say, for every rupee, I'll try and get back maybe, you know, 20 paise or 30 paise, whatever it may be. And three, of course, is you can say that, listen, I'm actually going to take the assets of these companies to market and try and retrieve as much money as possible, which is what the whole idea of sending those cases to the National Company Law Tribunal was. So this seems to be an admission that that is not working, that trying to recover money, I mean, you know, first of all, it's very difficult to identify assets and get them without encumbrances. When you get them, with, you know, you actually find that it's difficult to sell them because of the nature of the titles, etc. So the government is obviously saying that even those 12 companies, which account for 25% of the total non-performing assets, is not going to yield it very much, or the banks very much. So you're in essence saying that I'm going to take taxpayers' money in the long run and use it to recapitalize the banks because of the fact that I can't get those private players who took these large volumes of money from the public banks, who were encouraged by the state to lend to these projects, and you essentially are going to let off those people. As you say, it is a bailout. It is in the nature of a bailout, which actually is going to help big capital, which has used the opportunity of financial liberalization to take large credit from the banking system.
Is the recapitalization and the getting back, you know, whatever we can of the NPAs, are they mutually exclusive? Because the banking sector employees have been demanding some recapitalization because they were saying that credit is being squeezed because of lack of capital of the banks.
The government has to put in the money to recapitalize these banks. And I would have thought that the best way is for the government to actually have asked these banks to increase the size of their paid up capital and bought into more equity so that these banks get recapitalized with government ownership. Okay. Now, obviously, you're not doing that. You're basically saying that you're going to have some funny system by which the government is going to give money to the banks to recapitalize in terms of equity, but the banks are going to give the government that money by buying its bonds. Okay, so but as I said, I mean, you can't blame the banks for the position they are in. The banks are in the position they are in is because of the fact that the government, which shut down the development finance institutions in a country in which the corporate bond market is not very active, the government was forced to get the public banks, the private banks didn't do too much of this, to get the public banks to lend to projects which were part of its infrastructure creation as part of its neoliberal strategy. Because that the government had to create infrastructure, but it didn't want to do it from the budget because it had a fiscal deficit target of whatever, 3% or less. So therefore, it had to recapitalize. But the point is, just because it had to recapitalize doesn't mean that there is no political economy behind it. And what I'm trying to say is the political economy behind it is that you're socializing the losses of the public sector banks. And in doing that, what you're going to do is, in essence, let off these companies. Because then once the recapitalization happens, the pressure to actually go after them and try and find every bit of asset which you can sort of monetize is going to come down.
There has been an estimate that banks actually, public sector banks actually, are in need of capital to the tune of 4.5 lakh crores or 5 lakh crores, whereas government in effect announced maybe little, even less than 2 lakh crores. So also based on the comments of Chief Economic Advisor Arvind Subramaniam, there seem to be a plan, it seems to be deliberate, that less capital is given than is required because they want to shrink the banks or merge the banks or shut down the smaller banks. What would be the implications of this?
Let me put it this way. Listen, if the government had not adopted the Basel norms and said that you need a capital adequacy of this kind, And basically said that, listen, I'm going to use liquidity from the central bank or from the budget, whichever way you want to go about it, to keep propping up these banks, giving them time over a period of time to write off this and use their whatever remaining profits that they have to rebuild their books. That, you know, so long as they're sovereign banking, these banks are not going to collapse. So long as you use the right of note issue of the central bank as well as the budget of the government to back these banks, they wouldn't have got them. So really the problem is, if you say that, listen, I want a particular capital adequacy ratio to be realized as per the requirements of Basel III, which have got stricter, and I'm going to have more stricter guidelines for recognition of loss-making assets, then obviously you're caught in a recapitalization trap. Now, the point is, how much is that money? How much is it going to be? It would all depend also on how much more of the debt which has been provided in the period after 2004 is actually going to go bad. The more it goes bad, the more you'll have to recapitalize. But I don't think you're in a situation where you say that you need 4 lakh crores or you need 5 lakh crores. What you need would depend upon the degree to which you're saying that I'm not going to assert my right to provide sovereign banking to give time to the banking system to actually find its own feet, without putting pressure on it to lend to, you know, all sorts of infrastructure projects which are not going to take off, or lend to the hotel industry to build 7-star hotels and so on and so forth. Out of the private airlines, for that matter.
Thank you, Professor Chandrasekhar. Thank you for giving us your time.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.